Well, good morning, everyone. I'm Abhishek Bhadra. I'm one of the AIML practice leaders in Genpact. And I have close to 15 years of experience in analytics and consulting. That's my colleague, Dr. Prakash Selva Kumar.
Hi, everyone.
And he's also in the AIML practice team, and he's one of the top NLP experts in India. Okay, we also have our third co-author, Manik Garg. He's a young data scientist, also in the AIML practice team in India. So, considering this is a machine learning conference, we'll not really deep dive into what is natural language processing, okay? But just to summarize, computational linguistics or the study of natural language processing is an approach for machines to understand and translate and interpret certain languages by leveraging large volumes of data sets. In the last two, three years, you know, Prakash can vouch for that. What we have observed is that 60 to 70% of the business problems that we get from our clients are unstructured data problems.
That's absolutely correct.
And out of those problems, 70 to 80% are NLP problems. Now, if I have to quickly categorize the type of NLP problems that we solve, number one is entity extraction. What is entity extraction? Entity extraction is, for example, we are given few million invoices, and the algorithm is tasked to extract certain specific entities from those invoices, like the invoice amount, the quantity, the payer name, the payee name, address, and all that stuff, right? That's entity extraction. Second thing is sentiment analysis. For example, computing the sentiment score from the call center transcripts, right? We get that pretty often. Third one is a translation task. So you're given a contract, which is in language A, and you have to translate that contract from language A to language B, okay? Now, to solve these three types of problems, which, and I'm sure there are other types of NLP problems, that comes on our way as well, but these are the three prevalent types of problems that we solve. You need two things. The requirement is two basic things. First is you need a really fast computing power. Now, you know, a bunch of smart people actually solved that problem in the beginning of the 2010s when the data science community started using the GPUs instead of CPUs to train these neural nets. The second requirement is large volumes of clean and labeled data set. Our paper today kind of talks about solving a subset of that problem. Okay, we'll come to that problem. So, how do we get clean and labeled data set? 95% of the time, the data that we receive from our clients are in the format of PDFs. Okay, now, there are different methods of extracting data from PDFs. One of the prevalent methods, which we commonly use, is using this Python library called PDF Miner. Now, the biggest challenge of using PDF Miner is the output that you get out of this PDF Miner is continuous unsegmented text. Now, for all practical purposes, that's pretty useless because you cannot use that data to train any algorithm, right? So to zoom in further into the problem statement and the solution that we are proposing in our paper today, our algorithm transforms unsegmented continuous text into segmented meaningful text and sentences, correct? Using recurrent neural network. We'll get into the model and the details of the model in some time. So let's understand how our workflow in terms of how we how we went about in solving this problem. We actually used pretty simple steps and widely available data sets. So as a first step, we extracted all the English words in dictionary using the analytical library. All of us use that library for NLP. Now, once we extracted all the words from the English dictionary, the second step was to download the entire Wikipedia data set for a specific timestamp. You have to do it for a specific timestamp because otherwise you also get the edits and that kind of becomes terabytes of data set, right? We don't need so much of data. Now, once we had those two data sets, what we did was for every specific English word, we mapped those words to a bunch of sentences from the Wikipedia data set containing those words. Now, by doing this synthesis exercise, we created close to quarter million rows of data, okay? And so now what we have is quarter million rows of data. These are sentences which are segmented. These are meaningful sentences with blank spaces, right? Now this is our why. So now we reverse engineer to figure out how to get the X. We just wrote a few lines of code and we removed all the blank spaces from the same sentences and we created our X. So the sentences with blank spaces became our Y and the sentences without the blank spaces became our X. And we used a sequence-to-sequence model to train the algorithm. We'll get into the algorithm. So, I mean, once again, sequence-to-sequence model is also called the encoder-decoder model, right? Very simple. What we did was we fed the encoder with X. Our X was a sentence without the blank spaces. You can see it over there. And instead of using the final output of the encoder, we used the hidden layer to the final timestamp as a thought vector to the decoder. And the decoder generated the final segmented meaningful sentence. Okay. And the performance of the model was fairly accurate. We used the blue score and the root score to measure the performance of this model, and consistently we achieved 80% plus accuracy. Okay. So, lastly, to summarize, it's a very simple problem that we are solving today in this paper. We discussed about the typical NLP business problems that we solve in our day-to-day work. We spoke about the need in today's world to have large volumes of data set to train this deep neural nets. Then we spoke about the very specific problem statement, where there are limitations of the PDF miner library to extract meaningful segmented data sets. And lastly, we kind of spoke about the method and the workflow that we use to solve that problem. Okay. Now, I'm sure there are different other methods to solve a similar problem as well. We use this in most of our NLP problems. Reason being, this is a scalable solution. Secondly, you can feed the algorithm with domain-specific data, and that's why the solution is domain-agnostic, right? And we've deployed it at an enterprise level for multiple clients of ours, and then it has been a success. So that's our presentation today. So happy to take any questions. Can you repeat the question, please?
So you are extracting the words, right? How
My question is, so how are you extracting the text embedded in the image within the document?
So there are two kinds of PDFs we handle. One is digital PDF, another one is image PDF. And image PDF, we generally use Apache Tikka to extract those things. Basically, it's a OCR engine. We do the OCR engine and extract the text. To answer your question, how do we extract the text from the images is we use OCR engine to extract the text.
Okay, so initially you convert the given PDF into the image format, JPEG or something like that. On top of that, you run OCR to extract?
So as I told you earlier, in digital PDF, we do not have any issues. We straight away do the PDF mining and get the text out. And for the image, we use OCR engine. In this case, Apache Tikka, we the document may be in image format, or the document itself may have the images in it.
Yeah.
So embedded images or out of scope, we do not address that because our primary content is the text, not the image, and the image has the text that is out of scope.
Image, I meant even you might have some tables, right?
So yep.
That you consider as a, you know, not image or how are you? For example, if I have a amount within a table.
Yes.
Right. So such kind of use cases.
So all of them are taken care by the OCR engine itself.
Okay.
So we do not consider the tables especially, and then we do not consider the column data, all those things, because that is immaterial for our activity. So let's say if you process the invoice, then the table really matters, because you know you need to know the line items and the quantities and the price, all those things. So so this is a small piece in our complete pipeline.
Yeah.
The complete pipeline is meant for document search.
And you know, frankly speaking, the you know one of the so when we get the data from the clients, 60-70% of the time is actually digital PDFs. We try and avoid using image PDFs for all practical reasons, because you know it adds to the complexity, and it also depends, the dependency on the OCR increases,
yep.
Right? And I mean, we try and control that work scope by having that initial conversation with the clients.
Okay, thank you.
As well. It was, as we mentioned, it was almost 250,000 rows of data.
Approximately, I would say 3 or 4 GB of data. We didn't measure in terms of size. We know the number of rows. It's close to, as you mentioned, it is 250,000 records.
Okay.
So
yeah, I mean, few gigs.
Okay. So do you always get a structured data, or means exactly corrected English grammar data, or let's say spelling mistakes and all kind of those stuff?
That's a great question. Now let's understand the kind of problems that we get, right? Invoices typically, the entity extraction involves extracting the numbers, extracting the address, the names and all that stuff, right? The names and all, the proper nouns are the places where the algorithm really kind of gets stuck, because the English dictionary and the Wikipedia dataset would not have those names,
right?
So that's where the accuracy of the algorithm really goes down. So when there are spelling mistakes, they're kind of treated as proper nouns.
Yep. Right. Okay. Thanks.
Hi, I have a question. So first of all, it's a very nice presentation. Thanks for that. Given that the PDF solutions are becoming a commodity nowadays, right? You can find a lot of PDF extractors in the market. What has been your motivation to really train something, or did you try to benchmark your solution against any commercial solutions out in the market?
So that's very nice question. I like it. There are many products available in the market which claims that give the PDF and take the structured data out. But we measured the accuracy. It is close to, you may not believe it, it is close to 17%, 17%, and it is definitely not usable in the product. And why it is 17% is they try to solve at very high level. They try to give a very universal solution which will not fit to everybody's need. One size shirt will not fit everyone.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's a problem.
And see, let's look at our clients. Like for example, if an aviation client comes to us, we have to train the algorithm with domain specific data sets. So we have to add certain words. Like for example, words like HPT blade, stage 2, will not be there in the English dictionary data set, right? We need to kind of customize that algorithm to suit the solution that we are building for a specific client.
Hey, one question here, from here.
Hi.
Yeah, hi. So, what if you have a set of sentences that has a sequence, not within the sentence sequence, it's like between sentence sequence, and you gotta, you know, maintain the sequence as well. How would you handle it?
Will you please elaborate, please?
Let's take this scenario, right? I have a series of instructions in my document, and that series of instructions has to be, done in the same way as such. And I want to maintain that when I convert them into a labeled information, how would I maintain the sequence of the sentences as well?
So let me repeat your question to understand if I got the question correct. So you have an order of sentences, and if the order is messed up, then how you can bring back the order?
Yeah, between sentences.
Yes. So that's altogether a different problem statement. Yeah. If I do that, following would be my approach. Yeah. So let's say I have array of sentences, and I know the sequences of it. So that is my X. And I deliberately mess up the order, and then that is, sorry, I mess up the order and use that as X, and then the sentences in order would be Y.
Okay.
So I can train the neural network again with this new X and Y. Then when you get new bunch of sentences which are messed up, then you can bring the order back. Okay. So I wouldn't use a translation model for that. Instead, I would use sequence tagging for that.
Can you repeat that?
Sequence tagging.
Okay.
Excuse me. Hi, my name is Pavan.
Hello. Where are you, Pavan?
I am here.
Oh, hi, Pavan.
So what exactly is this domain-specific word segmentation here? So you are giving an input and you are actually identifying the domain? Or?
So So the reason we are calling it domain-specific word segmentation is, okay, as I said, the solution is domain agnostic.
Okay.
But you can feed the model, you can train the model with domain specific data set and make it a customized solution and make it a very domain specific solution. So that's why it's domain specific word segmentation. When we explained this model, we explained it with a very generic data set like the Wikipedia data set and the English dictionary, right? But the problem statements that we get from our clients are very very specific to industries like pharmaceuticals or CPG retail, where the words are very domain specific. I mentioned high pressure turbine blades, right, which is a very aviation specific word. That's why this solution is a domain specific word segmentation.
Okay. And you actually, like, when you go to a new domain, you collect a set of data set from their
data collection, and then
you,
is data
you
collection.
Retrain.
Yes, you retrain the model.
Only
see, if it's a contact center transcript which does not have too much of domain specific information, we might end up using this model. But I mean, in our world, we have never got any problems which are generalized in nature.
If I try to create a universal model which is which can be used for any domain, then we cannot create the model this model at all, because the data set would be huge.
Yeah.
So now we focus on specific domain so that the data set is manageable, and the synthetic data what we generate is also enough to create our model.
Yes. And in Genpact, we are calling this as pre-trained AI accelerators. Okay. Does it solve all the problems in day one? No, because we need to add to the data sets, right? But it definitely reduces the training hours. It definitely reduces the coding hours, because you're just customizing the code. So these are pre-trained accelerators. So if it's a 6 months execution, we probably reduce that to 3 months. I'm just giving a hypothetical number. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Hi. Right here. Here, this side. So while processing the invoices, the clients will be getting the invoices from the multiple vendors, right? And multiple vendors can have their own structure of the invoices, and might be it can differ the type of the invoices.
Hmm.
So are you training the model, customized model for each of the invoices type, or it is generalized in a way to extract the information out of it?
I can talk about this for one day. So we did a lot of research in this area. So what I call is that template-based modeling. That's one solution. For example, one vendor will follow one template. If you create a model specific to that template, then your F1 score would be close to 92%. Numbers also in my mind. And if you try to create a universal model, it will go up to 86% of F1 score. I'm not talking about accuracy, I'm talking about F1 score, which is more robust. And answer to your question is that without seeing the data, I cannot recommend anything. So it is based on the data. If the templates have the common pattern, then we can create one universal model that can extract the entities from all the templates, meaning all vendors can be treated with one model. If not, then we do not have other option other than creating a template specific model.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Hey, hi.
Hi.
Sorry. Yeah. I think this will be easier.
Yes.
Yeah, taking off from one of the earlier questions. So just to understand this a little bit more. So the output of your model is going to extract the entities specific for a client. Is that understanding?
That's the next step.
All right.
If I may categorize this, this can be a data pre-processing step for most of our modeling exercise. So because you need clean and labeled data for training the neural nets, right?
Okay.
All we are doing is we are preparing a clean and labeled data set so that we can successfully train the next step, like entity extraction model or translation model or the sentiment analytics model, right? That is the final goal.
All right.
What we are showing out here, that is not the final outcome. This is just a small segment of the larger problem that we are solving.
Okay, so there's natural language in the PDF documents that you're extracting, and what's going to be the output? That's pre-processed natural language text?
Yes.
Yes.
That's right.
All right.
Hi.
Hi.
Yeah. So I see that you have used sentences. So instead of sentences, did you try using just bigrams?
No.
Or did it have any effect on accuracy? You didn't try.
It might.
We didn't try. Because the reason is, we find this is very simple, and bigram might work. Yes, I agree.
Because it will have more number of training sets, I guess.
Yes, more training sets. Another one is that in this approach, creating the synthetic data and handling or generating the model out of is kind of spoon feeding. So if it is bigram, then you have to supervise it, and then you may have to tweak it. So as I told you earlier, this is to me is a simple spoon feeding method.
Yep. At times the simplest solutions work the best.
Excuse me. Hi.
Hi.
So one of the most important things in NLP is the stemming of words that we do.
Mm-hmm.
So suppose we have a use case where some derived form of the word appear in your sentence. So how's your algorithm gonna handle that use case?
The English dictionary kind of takes care of that.
English dictionary has just stemmed words, or it has the derived forms also?
It has the derived forms as well.
So it has entire derived
forms. Yeah. But great question.
Yes.
Okay.
I think your question is answered, but I still want to give little more details about what we are trying to do. So there is a function hidden between the unsegmented sentence and the segmented sentence. We are trying to unearth that function using the neural network. So if you have a sentence like, for example, running and run, that's what you are meaning. So if you have a dictionary which has all of them, so still that function which is hidden behind this can be learned by the neural network. Explicitly you feeding it into the algorithm. So if your final blue score or rogue impacts, then we may have to zoom in and then see why it impacts. So in our case, we didn't get any impact like that.
Thank you.
Hi. Hello.
Yeah, I was wondering if you were using like character to index features for feeding to the model or word to index, because initially the words were not segmented or not classified. Yeah.
So we are not dealing at the word level itself. So it is what we are trying to, the function between X and Y is the segmentation. So it doesn't understand whether it is a word or not. There are cases it can break the word as well, but then we have to zoom in and find out the root cause and prepare a data set such a way that it understands the tokens properly.
Yeah.
So understanding the language comes the next step.
Okay.
Hi, this is
Anita
here. My question is slightly different from what we're talking, but around text mining. We are trying to solve a case where there are images in a document, Word doc, and that image is a technical specification of a tool, say a product, a part. So, and we have to extract the technical specifications from that image.
Yep.
So,
can I ask you, are you from G?
No, I'm from Land Research, that's a semiconductor.
Okay. Once again, we are getting this request pretty often. Okay. We can chat offline about it.
Sure, thank you so much.
Thank you.
So do you want to answer this?
We'll take it offline.
I have a question here.
Sure.
So sometimes when I was working on some PDF near extraction, so during that time we are facing an issue like we are trying to extract some numerical numbers. Okay, for example, it is 7. Numerical form it is, and sometimes it is SEVN7 in the word form. So in that case, how this preprocessing would work?
So you have to prepare a data set such a way that, for example, 7, if your data has, you have a data set with number 7, and you expect that SEVN can also occur at the time of inferencing, you have to generate additional synthetic data saying that the 7 has to be translated to SEVN in words, and then consider both samples as X and then train the algorithm. So the idea is that you have to teach the algorithm both number 7 is also 7 in your case, and SEVN is also a 7. So if you teach that, then algorithm will pick it up and treat both of them as one and the same.
Okay, so the number can be any number, right? So with all the numbers, do you have to train the model?
It's data specific. For example, if you have a limited number of samples, you can multiplex it. For example, 7, take one sample which has some numbers. Let's take 1, 2, 3, and then you can replace that with 4, 5, 6. 7, 8, 9, 11, 12, 13, etc. And you can also translate that into text. So now with one sample, you generated another 7, 8. You can generate 1 million as well. So there is a function which is hidden in these things. We are trying to induce the algorithm to pick up that function. That will be your weights. At the time of inferencing, it is expected to interpret that.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome.
Hi.
Lot of people fill their education detail in tabular format. So earlier one gentleman asked if there will be table, how will I handle this? Like it's for now you guys are avoiding taking that PDF if it will have table. But if it's there, how will I handle with this problem?
So the algorithm understands only the features. So it is all about how do we convert that table in terms of features and feed it to the algorithm. So let's say if I do the OCR, then each token will have the coordinates, X, Y, top, bottom. So along with the token, these features should also be given as additional features to the algorithm to learn. So for example, if I would design the solution, I would consider all of them a flat text, and then I find the token coordinates and I label it such a way that this is the starting of the table and this is the end of the table. This is how we can handle in the world of NLP.
We have to give the coordinates.
Yes, as an additional feature. So there are two ways to solve this. One is that you can solve using computer vision. You can...
Table size will be different than coordinate.
Ah, see, this is the pain that we have to take at the train of training, at the time of training. So we need to generate the training set which has all these details. So without this, because there is a function, again, there is a pattern hidden in the data that will be captured using the coordinates only in this case. So there is a different way to tackle it in computer vision, but I am talking about simple text-oriented method.